سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وعلى من سار على نهجه إلى يوم الدين. As you see, today we started at 7 and we hope that we finish 15 to 8 so we can catch the Isha prayer till the time, inshallah, getting more longer. So I hope this will be also suitable for brothers and sisters, especially in the east of Asia, because you know, when we stay late, it will be too late for them. So today, alhamdulillah, we'll start a new topic, which is about fasting. And it is, alhamdulillah, blessing from Allah Azza wa Jal. And it is tawfiq that Allah Azza wa Jal blessed us, that we were able to cover all things related to tahara, purification, salah, and the prayer, and then zakah, which is charity. And now we move to siyam and fasting. It is, alhamdulillah, blessing from Allah because it's come in the right time. So maybe 8 weeks from now, Ramadan will arrive. May Allah Azza wa Jal give us all the health and the help to live at that till that day, and we fast this Ramadan and many coming Ramadan, inshallah, many Ramadan to come. So it will be very important for the Muslim always to do his ibadah on the base of the knowledge of the revelation. As you know, many times we mentioned that there are two preconditions for accepting any type of ibadah. Very important conditions. What are they? Ikhlas wal mutabah. Sincerity, that's the mean. The act of ibadah should be sincerely, was done sincerely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not for any other reason. And mutabah, that's mean following the example of the Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam and applying the guidelines of the teaching of the Quran and the Sunnah. Therefore, by learning, inshallah, in these 8 weeks, which will be around only 8 meetings, when we discuss and explain different narrations which are related to fasting, so by the time, inshallah, time Ramadan come, inshallah, every one of us will be equipped with the needed knowledge, which is the very important knowledge, the essential knowledge, that when we do our fasting, inshallah, Ramadan, we do it with a light. With a light. That means we do it according to the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet, alayhi salatu wassalam. Not just as habit. And unfortunately, many Muslims, many millions, they fast Ramadan as tradition. That's come every year, this holy month come, the whole community, neighborhood, relatives, everybody in the community are fasting, let's fast. Only just imitating other without knowing many of the rules of fasting. This is why many people, unfortunately, they fall in many mistakes, which may nullify their fasting, may make their fasting not valid. So this is why it is very important to start this ibadah, this act of worship, by learning how to do it, learning what is the requirement for it, learning what are the things that will nullify it. All this is very important for the believer to know. So at the beginning, before we go to the narrations, I already shared with you the hadith that we are going, inshallah, to discuss today. But before we start, you know, discussing this hadith, let's go with this very short introduction about this important subject, which is fasting. Many people, maybe they ask or they wonder, what is fasting mean? This is one reason why there in our book, there is what we call it chapter, what we call it fasl. This is the Arabic division. You see, from any book of fiqh, the ulama, they divide it you know, it's like tree, which means, you know, they start for any subject, they try to get all subject under one title, they call it book. So they call it Kitab al-Siyam, Kitab al-Siyam, the book of fasting. It's not chapter here. This is like a section. So we talk about the book of purification, the book of prayer, and now we are in the book of fasting. It's like a section which is about fasting. And then in every book or every section, there is also another, you see, level of subtitle or sub-subjects. So this book, which is about fasting, you see, you remember when we talk about salah, we talk about different type of salah, obligatory salah, sunan rawatib, Friday salah, the salah of the two Eids, the salah of night's prayer. We talk about funeral prayer. And then when we talk about zakah, we talk about different also subject, like zakat al-fitr, like the zakah of gold, the zakah of silver. And now we talk about fasting. This is a book of fasting. So the book of fasting include also what are, you know, many things about Ramadan, about conditions of fasting, preconditions of fasting, about obligatory fasting, about things that nullify fasting, all this. So today we are starting with a new book, which is the book of fasting. First of all, let's ask this question. What does it mean, fasting? In Arabic, it's called siyam. Siyam from the verb sama. Sama, this is verb in the past tense. Sawm, noun. As-siyam, noun, like the fasting. Now, what does the word sama means? In the Arabic, it means to abstain. That means to stop doing certain thing. This was mentioned in the Quran when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Maryam, chapter number 19, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَقُولِي إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ لِلرَّحْمَنِ صَوْمًا. This is ayah, verse number 26. If anybody talk to you, ask you, oh Maryam, what is this? Don't speak to them. Just say, I am make obligation to Allah Azza wa Jal that I will, I made oath to Allah Azza wa Jal that today I'm fasting. So, فَلَنْ أُكَلِّمَ الْيَوْمَ إِنْسِيَّ. So explain, what does it mean by her fasting? فَلَنْ أُكَلِّمَ الْيَوْمَ إِنْسِيَّ. So today, I'm not going to speak to any human being. So this is the meaning of fasting. So she abstained from talking, from speaking. So what does the meaning of fasting as a religious obligation or as Islamic term? Because you remember many times we said for anything or any term, there are two meanings, the linguistic meaning and the meaning al-istilah. The istilah, that means the term as it's known by the scholars of that area of knowledge. So among ulama, the Islamic concept, fasting, they define it as follow. I would like you to please to concentrate with me because every word in this definition has a meaning. Let's say it in Arabic first. As-sawm huwa at-ta'abbudu lillah subhanahu wa ta'ala bil-imsaki 'an al-muftirat min tulu' al-fajr ila ghurub al-shams. So this definition is complete, comprehensive, included everything that you want to know it about fasting. Let's now discuss one by one after we say it in English. هو التعبد لله. It is worshiping Allah. It is an act of worship for Allah. This is the first one. By what? By abstaining from anything that will be considered as nullifier for this fasting. From the time dawn, the time of Salat al-Fajr, till sunset. This is the definition of fasting. Now let's go to discuss this definition. Why it said at the beginning, هو التعبد لله. Fasting is an act of worship. Because maybe some people, they fast, they stop eating or drinking to lose weight, you know, to be model, they didn't find the food to eat, or many other reasons. But here we are recalling the intention, the intention of the action. What is our intention when we stay away from eating, from drinking? What is our motive? Is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why, as we remember, we talk about the hadith of niyat, which was mentioned and narrated by Umar radiallahu anhu, said, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ مْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى. All deeds, but for what? Depend on what? On niyyah, on intention. So this is the first thing that we know it about the definition of fasting. It is an act of worship for Allah Azza wa Jalla, not for anything, any other reason. By stopping, abstaining from any things which will nullify the fasting, what are they? Muftirat, it's called. We'll discuss it, inshallah. It is food, eating, drinking, anything that get into the body, having intimate relation, many other things, inshallah, we'll talk about it when it's come to that point. And now the timing. The timing is when the span of time, from the time of Salat al-Fajr, when the Adhan of Fajr call, till the time of Maghrib, which is sunset. So this is the daytime. During the daylight, this is the time that we don't eat or drink. This is the time that we are fasting. So it is very clear now. Now we mention the niyyah, the intention. We mention the action, what we do. And we mention the time span for that action. So this is the meaning for fasting. So this is as introduction for our. Now, what is the status of fasting in Islam? Islam, in fact, fasting, as-siyam, is one of the pillars of Islam. Every Muslim, he knows it. He knows it. We know that Islam, as it was the hadith that was mentioned by Ibn Umar, radiallahu anhum, who said, Buniya al-Islamu ala khams. Islam was established or built on five. And you know what? Shahada, Salah, Zakah, and we already covered this. And then fasting. So fasting is one of the pillars of Islam, and the fifth one, as you know, Al-Hajj. Right. What is the rule of fasting? Is it obligatory? Is it voluntary? It is obligatory. Right. Where we can get this from? Where is the dalil? What is the proof? The proof is clear in the Quran. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, kutiba alaykum as-siyam, kama kutiba ala ladhina min qablikum. This is Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 183. O you who believed, fasting prescribed for you. That's mean you should fast, as it was prescribed for many nations ahead of you. So it is fard. Prescribed, that's mean it is fard. That it is must, it is obligation. The other dalil from the sunnah. The Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُوهُ فَصُومُوا. That means when you see the crescent of Ramadan, then صُومُوا, then fast. This word is mean command. And as we know, in the fiqh, you know, terminology, they said, الْأَمْرُ لِلْوُجُوبِ. Al-amr lil-wujub. So when it's command, that means it's become what? It has become must, unless there are other, you know, adilla or evidences that will turn it from must to what? To recommend it. But here for fasting, no question, it is must on every Muslim. By the Quran, as we mentioned in the ayah, by the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and also by ijma'. And al-ijma' that mean all Muslim from all sects. No one said that fasting is not and thus must. Nobody, you know, ever said that fasting is not must. طيب. Now, the one who fasts, for sure he do his obligation. What's the rule for the one who said fasting is not must? Now, the ulama said, the one who say this, the one who say that fasting is denying the obligation of fasting, this he is getting from the belief to the disbelief. Why? Because he denies something which is confirmed in the deen, and it is one of the pillars of the deen. No question, no disagreement among ulama. The one who said, no need for fasting, this is up to you to fast or not. This is disbelief, getting out of the religion, because this is one of the pillar. If one, he didn't believe in the pillar, that's mean the whole structure is full down. Right? How about who said, yes, I know that it is fast is must. I am Muslim and I believe that we should fast, but he doesn't fast. Laziness, because he is sometimes sneaking, eating, drinking. He's committing major sin, no question about this. And the Prophet ﷺ said, Man aftara yawman fi Ramadan, if one, he break the fast of one day of Ramadan, it will not be covered up or made up if he even he fast the whole, the rest of all his life, which show that it is very important. But some ulama, they said also this will include, but as good, but the sound view that he's still a Muslim, he's still a believer, but he's committing major sin. طيب, what are the wisdoms of fasting? In fact, my dear brothers and sisters, you know, whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala command us to do, there is wisdom behind it. There is reason, there is logic, there is benefit. Now, some of these we know and some we don't. Why? Because no matter what knowledge we have, it doesn't, and uncomparable to the knowledge and the wisdom of Allah Azza wa Jal, who know the seen and the unseen. So we should put this in our mind. So anything, any command, we like sometimes, we feel it is difficult or hard, or maybe our self doesn't like that much. As long as it is a command from Allah Azza wa Jal to command us to do or not to do, for sure there are many benefits, there are many wisdoms, but our mind, our intelligence may not comprehend all this. So what are the benefits or the wisdom of fasting? Subhanallah. You see, if you look at Islamic regulation, it treats human being and educate him in very nice matter, very nice way. Sometimes by, you know, command him to give from something that he loves, to test how much he is selfish or he's willing to give up for the sake of Allah. Like when we talk about charity or zakah, everyone loves money and he loves his wealth. So Allah commanded us to give zakah. Why? To tell us that this money is under or with our hand, and it's not in our heart. So we are willing to give it for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. Sometimes ibadah, or act of worship, is to stop doing something that we love, like food, eating, like, you know, drinking, especially water, coffee, you know, tea. Some people, even some people, they smoke. May Allah Azza wa Jal forgive them and help them to get rid of this habit. Okay? And everyone, as a human being, he loves to have relation. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us not to do it in certain time during Ramadan. This is fasting. Why? This, my dear brothers, to teach us to have self-control. So our desire, ourself, not controlling us, but we are in the command and we are the one who tell ourselves that to do or not to do by training. So subhanallah, this is wisdom from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes other ibadat, Allah Azza wa Jalla command you to movement and go and travel, and like hajj. Subhanallah. Or like salah, that you wake up from your sleep in the early morning, or you go to the masjid 5 times. All this ibadat, in fact, is, you know, like training course for us to purify our soul, to keep us in control of ourselves, not following our desire, not be to deceive by the shaitan, not also to deceive by many shaitan, no matter who are they, may somebody be human or jinn or any other things. So look at the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now when we talk about fasting, subhanallah, it is very interesting that there are many benefits. First of all, it is healthy. For the full year, you have been eating, drinking, so 1 month, just give, you know, a vacation or less work for your stomach, for insight. We say this for those people who understand the concept of fasting, not those ignorant who just flip-flop, they change the timing of the night to the day to the night. So instead of eating three meals during the day, they do it at night. They benefit nothing. But the wise person, he know that during Ramadan, he should not eat that much, and this will give some. Also the circle, subhanAllah. And many benefits, and many health benefits, it's not our subject, but this is one reason. Another reason, or wisdom, that we learn to teach us how to be patient. How to be patient. So if we are patient for something that is essential for our life, like food and water, which is we cannot live without, that we can stay for some time, this to teach us that we can be patient in other situations. The same thing, if we can give up for a certain time something which is part of our need, like drinking water, that means we have the ability to leave and desert, you know, these some habits which is not necessary for our life, like smoking or like, you know, drinking some of these drinks which may not be good for our health. Right. Also in fasting, people, especially those who are rich, those who are fortunate, they have food. Sometimes they don't know what to do with it. They remember that there are many people who are less fortunate in this world. They stay days. They don't find anything to eat. They maybe eat dry bread. They find it outside. They look for it, subhanAllah. So when the Muslim fasts, and feel the hunger, and this, he becomes thirsty, he remember those brothers and sisters in many countries, those refugees that, you know, they are less fortunate than him. So first he will be what? Thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing the blessing of Allah azza wa jal that Allah gave it to him. And also he should be sympathized with his brothers and sisters who are in need. So he do whatever he can to help them. And then look around you in your community, in your neighborhood. Remember that, well, I'm eating every day. My neighbor so-and-so, I see him that he doesn't have any job. He's jobless. He has nothing. Subhanallah, and he has children. So maybe he is in need for some food. So I go and help him and feed him. So this is to show you this. Also, my dear brother, fasting is, subhanAllah, is helping us to control ourselves against the shaitan. Because it is mentioned that the shaitan is running in the veins, the blood veins. So when the person fasting, and this veins is not, you know, filled with food and working, so it become less tight. And this is why the Prophet of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he advised those young men, those youth who they are not able to get married, you know, instead to fast. So when they fast, this will help them to control their desire. And also, you know, fasting, subhanAllah, you know, get us very close to Allah Azza wa Jal. Why? In Ramadan, many recitation of the Quran, night prayer, subhanAllah, and the person when he's fasting, he's not willing, you know. So the soul become a light, not covered with the heavy load of the physical body, which is filled with food. And this is why, my dear brothers, this is our sum of the wisdom that we learn it from fasting. And this is why Ramadan is a blessed month that Allah Azza wa Jal revealed the Quran in Ramadan. Shahr Ramadan alladhi unzila fihi al-Quran. And the last point is, look to the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we as Muslim, we don't depend on solar calendar. We depend on lunar calendar. So this month of fasting, Ramadan, sometimes it's come during the springtime, sometimes come at the winter season, sometimes at the summer. So subhanAllah, all type of season. And so we can fast in any situation. So this is like an introduction. Let's go now to our inshallah, hadith that we'll discuss. And let's just start with reading the first hadith. Will you go ahead, brother Al-Majid, and read for us? Jazakallah.
Can you see the screen, Sheikh?
Yeah, can you see it?
No.
You didn't see the screen? I already shared. It's not clear, yeah, Al-Majid?
No, Sheikh.
Okay, let me start again. Okay. Is it clear?
Yes.
Okay, now.
Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, none of you should fast a day or two before the beginning of the month of Ramadan, unless it is a day on which one is in the habit of fasting, that is, voluntary fasting that coincides with that day agreed upon.
The next one, because it's related also.
Ammar bin Yasir, radiallahu anhu, narrated, whoever fasts the day of doubt, he has then disobeyed Abu al-Qasim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, related by the five Imams, and Ibn Khuzaimah and Ibn Hibban graded it as Sahih.
Right. The first hadith, which was narrated by Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, said, La tuqaddimu Ramadan bi sawmi yawmin aw yawmin, which means it's not right, it's not correct, it's forbidden for any person to start Ramadan one day or two earlier. Some people, they are highly motivated. They think that, you know, just to make sure that we don't miss the first day of Ramadan because maybe they didn't see the moon and the crescent is there, but nobody see it. They call it Yawm al-Shak, the day of doubt. That there is doubt that this day, one of Ramadan. So they go and fast. So this is prohibited. This is haram. This is forbidden based on this hadith. So it's not lawful for a person to fast before it is announced in the community, in the society, by the ruler, okay, by the authority, by the group of scholar in the community, that we saw the crescent so far, and then therefore we will start fasting tomorrow. So anyone who violate this and fast one day earlier, this is committing sin. Except, what is the exception? The exception if the person, he get used to fast. Let's say, for example, a person or a man or woman, they used to fast every Monday and Thursday. And alhamdulillah, many Muslims, they do this. So the day, which is the 30th of Sha'ban, it came as on Monday, which is the day of doubt, that could be Ramadan, could be not. If this person used to fast Monday And then he fasts this day because as a habit for him, not as to be a part of Ramadan, then it is okay. If somebody is not used to fast that day, then it is forbidden for him to fast. Wait. And the other hadith was very clear that the one who do this, disobey Abu al-Qasim. Who is Abu al-Qasim? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is his nickname, Abu al-Qasim, the father of al-Qasim, and al-Qasim is his first son. So therefore we learn from this now. Now, no one should put in his mind or plan to fast one day or two before the day of, before the start of Ramadan. Some ulama, they said this so people, they will know the difference between obligatory fasting and what? And nafila. So he'll not mix this of them. Na'am. And also from this, when he said 1 or 2 days, like how about 3 days? It's okay. That's mean not 3 days together. No. What I mean that, for example, you fast the 26th of Sha'ban. It's okay. But 27, 28, 29, which is the last 2 days of Sha'ban, this is what was mentioned here because he said day or two. So some ulama they said it is not recommended to fast at the last part of Ramadan after of Sha'ban, which is the month before Ramadan. Right. Now let's go to the next hadith. I don't know if you can see it.
Can scroll it up, Sheikh?
Okay.
Umar. Ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhuma narrated, I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, start fasting after you have seen it, that is the new crescent, and end the fast at the end of the month when you have seen it. If it is overcast and cannot be seen, then estimate its sighting, that is, presume that Sha'ban lasted for 30 days, agreed upon. Muslim narrated, if it is too overcast to be seen, then presume that it is Sha'ban lasted for 30 days. In another narration by al-Bukhari, wait until 30 days of it, Sha'ban have passed.
Now, Ramadan, as we said here, the command of the Prophet ﷺ that we should start the fasting when it is become confirmed that the new crescent, the crescent of Sha'b, of Ramadan, is already seen and announced by the authority, by the formal authority in the community. Doesn't matter if they are ruler like in a Muslim country, or if it is in a group of Muslim living in non-Muslim country and they have scholars, Council of Scholars, okay, or Islamic Center, then when it's announced, then they should fast. Fasting, my dear brothers and sisters, when it was become obligatory, it was not come at once. The first level, I mean, the first step to teach the believers, a Muslim, to fast, was to fast one day, which is Ashura, the 10th of Muharram. And then the second stage was to fast Ramadan by choosing either to fast or to give food. As Allah Azza wa Jalla said, وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ يُطِيقُونَهُ فِدْيَةٌ طَعَامُ مِسْكِينَ فَمَنْ تَطَوْعَ خَيْرًا فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَهُ وَأَنْ تَصُومُ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. This is Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 184. Those who are able to fast, but they don't want to fast, and they give fidya, that means feeding a needy, it's okay for them. But the one who fasts is better for him. So this is it. And then it's come the last command when Allah Azza wa Jalla said in ayah, verse 185, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصم. Then there's no excuse, no exception. Whoever was present and know that Ramadan started, then he should fast. طيب. So from this, we know that it is not lawful to start the fast before Ramadan. Now, some people, they may ask this question for a person who is troubling. We know that troubler, and this is coming to discuss, the troubler is exempted. That means it is lawful for him to break the fast. Now, many brothers and sisters, they ask, how about if in my community, in my area, in my country, people, they depend on calculation, not on seeing the moon. Should I fast on this or should I follow other country? Ulama have different view regarding this. Some of them, they said he should look to the nearest community or country where people depend on the crescent, so he follow them. Others, they said, no, we should follow the people in your community to keep the unity of the community. And since the scholars in your area, they choose to make this calculation, then should follow them. So, and inshallah, we'll talk about what the situation for the person who has a troubling naam. Right, what's the next hadith? Umar?
Ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhuma narrated, the people were trying to cite the new moon of Ramadan, and when I reported to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that I had seen it, he fasted and commanded people to fast. Related by Abu Dawood and Al-Hakim and Ibn Hibban graded it as Sahih.
Right. Before we come to this point, just to continue explaining the previous hadith, it said, "Fain ghumma alaykum." That means if it was the day where we should sighting the moon, there was cloud. So there is the possibility that there is Ramadan or not. That crescent is there, but we don't see it. What should we do? We should make calculation. Since there is sand, storm, or there is fog, or what they call it, there is clouds, then we should continue to al-iddah, which means to complete the month. That means to complete the month of Sha'ban, 30 days. And then we start the fasting. So it's very important to cite in the moon. In this hadith, Ibn Umar, what he said, "Tara an-nas al-hilal." That's people went out to check and look, you know, about the crescent, to see it. And I saw it. He was a young man, mashallah, with good sighting, and he sighted the moon. So he told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "O Prophet of Allah, I saw the new crescent." What was the response of the Prophet alayhi wa sallam? He commanded people to fast. What do we learn from this? That to start Ramadan, it is enough to have one witness, one person. If trustworthy person, trustworthy, truthful person sighted the moon from Ramadan at the beginning, then the whole community will take his word and then they will fast, which is different from the end of the month. But to break the fast at the end of Ramadan, we need two witnesses, two people, not only one. So this is very, very important to understand regarding this naam. Right. The next one. The next one also, it confirms what we said. Go ahead, yeah, brother
Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma narrated, a Bedouin came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, I have sighted the crescent of Ramadan. He then said to him, do you testify that there is none worthy of worship but Allah? The Bedouin said, yes. He asked him again, do you testify that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah? The man replied, yes. The messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam thereupon said, O Bilal, announce to the people to start fasting tomorrow. Related by the five Imams, Ibn Khuzaimah and Ibn Hibban graded it as Sahih. And Nasai said that it is most probably Mursal, a hadith in which the link between the successor and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is missing.
Right. This is also confirm what we said before, that, you know, if one trusts, and why the Prophet ﷺ asked him here, that do you believe in Allah? Do you believe in Muhammad ﷺ as a Rasulullah? That means the person or the shahid or the one who witnessed this sighting should be what? Should be a Muslim. Should be a Muslim. Since he is Muslim, then we assume that he is, inshallah, a truthful. Unless we know about this person or there's some background about him that he is not a trustworthy person, then we will check this. Alhamdulillah, nowadays, in many countries, they depend and it's okay to use a telescope, to use a center to sight the moon, as they do here, alhamdulillah, in Saudi Arabia, by the grace of Allah Azza wa Jal. The government, alhamdulillah, here, they put different centers to sighting the moon and a group of specialists, of astrologists, ulama, and judges. They come at that night and they're using this telescope and try to find out if there's in many different places to sight the moon. So if a Muslim person, and he's a trustworthy person, and then he told the authority that he saw the moon, and then they took his testimony, and then they will announce the start of Ramadan. I think we stop here today, inshallah. And the next week, inshallah, we'll continue about another topic, which is related to Ramadan and fasting. We'll leave sometimes for your question, because it is time for Adhan al-Isha here. Jazakumullah. Barakallah. If you have any question, please. I prefer that you start with questions which are related to our topic. And just remember that, inshallah, there are everything about Ramadan and fasting. It will be covered in our coming class. Barakallah. Okay.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh. This is Nabi Khan. How are you?
Wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullah. Hayyakallah ya Nabi, ya Nabi. Kayfa haluk anta wal usra wal awlad?
Alhamdulillah. Kullu tamam. Quick question, Sheikh. You talked about some people poor not having food or for doing the fasting. The question is, can we give zakat money, use the zakat money to buy some rice or some, all the things that they need and give them in kind, without giving cash, buy the thing and make a packets and then give to them? Is it allowed to use the zakat money to give like this?
No, for zakat money, it should be given to the poor or the needy, and he can buy whatever he want. Okay, we not controlling and say give it to him. In a matter of food or product or anything else, give him the money and then decide. Unless there is, like, for example, if the head of the family, for example, he is not in fact a good person, like a person who may addicted to drugs, or and if he was giving this money to his family, will not benefit from this. Then maybe you see somebody close to him and to tell him that there is zakah for him, but you know, give like authority for so and so, he will receive it and he will spend it on you. This is something arrangement, but this is a special case. But in general, we say that for zakat al mal, it should be given as money, as we said. Now, easy, brother Abdul Majid, will you mute all and give only chance for those brothers and sisters who have questions?
Question, Sheikh, why they give like this is because if you buy in bulk rice, for example, you get for cheap. With the same money, they cannot buy all this stuff that is being given. So that's why they do a community service. They take the zakat money and make packets and give it to you. And also sometimes this head of the people, as you said, may not be a good person. If you give them cash, they will not use it properly. That's the reason.
Well, this depends, my dear brother, depends on this poor and needy. For example, if he said, well, I will give wakala. You know what does it mean, wakala? You know, I consider this organization as my agent, okay? So they will take this money in my behalf. This is, it's okay. But we should not, you know, compel the needy for something or production. Just give him the money. Now, if he agree to give, as I said, a certain person authority as an agent, that's been somebody who act in his behalf, it's okay to give it to this person. And then he's spending the way that you said. He can buy for him some goods or something like that. Now, any other questions?
Thank you.
You're welcome. Fine. Is there any questions?
We close.
Alaykum salam wa rahmatullah. Naam.
I live in Texas, and my question is, if Saudi Arabia is 7 hours ahead of us here in Texas, so if the moon is sighted in Saudi Arabia, but the moon is not sighted in Texas, can I join the day that Saudi Arabia start their fasting? Because my belief is the world is round. So if one area if one area sees the moon, so we should also see the moon.
Well, no, that's not necessary, my dear sister. It's not necessary, you know, that if it was seen in one place, it could be seen in other place. This is one. Second, we depend when we take a decision regarding to the Sharia, to the deen, we depend on fatwa from scholars, not what we think it is right or not, okay? So anyway, in your community, I mean, in the town that you are there, if there is a Muslim community and they have authority, you know, like an Islamic center, or a group of scholars there, and they have council, and then they decide when to fast, then you should follow them, not following Saudi Arabia, which is a different place. So this is a correct way, my dear sister. Nah.
Okay. Jazakallah khair.
Tayyib. Jazakumullah khair. So anyway, if you have a question, inshallah you can ask next week or you post it in the group, and inshallah it will be answered next week. It is time for Salah here. Barakallah feekum, jazakumullah khair. See you inshallah next Sunday at 7 p.m. As today. Jazakumullah khair. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the health and the good life to reach Ramadan and fast the month of Ramadan and many Ramadans inshallah to come. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all of us with his forgiveness and his mercy. And may Allah Azza wa Jal forgive all Muslims, the living and the dead. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cure all the sick brothers and sisters and give them good health and give them very quick recovery. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give victory for the Muslim Ummah. Wa barakallahu feekum, jazakumullah khair. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alaykum
as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Jazakumullah khair, Sheikh.
Alaykum.